Sharon Salzberg is a central figure in the field of meditation, a world-renowned teacher and New York Times author. She has played both a pivotal and crucial role in bringing meditation and mindfulness practices to the West and into our mainstream culture since 1974, when she first began teaching, and she's here. She is the co-founder of the Insight Meditation Society, author of 10 books, including the New York Times bestseller, Real Happiness, her seminal work, Loving Kindness, and her upcoming release by Flatiron Books, Real Love. Renowned for her down-to-earth teaching style, Sharon offers a secular approach to Buddhist teachings, making them instantly accessible to everyone. There's more. She's a regular columnist for On Being, a contributor to the Huffington Post, and the host of her own podcast, The Metta Hour. Plus, with her very busy schedule, she's here with us today. Such a gift. Her talk, so apt for our gathering today, deepening your practice with loving kindness. Sharon Salzberg. Thank you.
Why don't you all come in and get comfortable. It's such a delight to be here in this beautiful space, in this incredibly, do you hear my echo? I hear my echo. Incredibly welcoming and hospitable environment, so thank you so much. I was gonna be here, as many of you know, anyway. I just left a conference at the Sheraton on some of the research, and I said my ears are funny and they don't always fit these things, but I don't know exactly why. Maybe my brain doesn't fit either. A conference on meditation research and sort of the movement in that field, as well as what for me has been a really amazing kind of discovery, which is, or unfolding, which is the movement of practices like mindfulness and now more and more loving kindness and compassion meditation into various clinical settings, and seeing the immense number of places where these techniques are being utilized in the effort to decrease suffering everywhere. So I began my own practice, also as many of you know, in 1971. I had gone to India as a college student. It was basically my junior year abroad. There was an independent study program at the university, which was in Buffalo, New York, State University of New York at Buffalo, which had an independent study program where if you created a project that they liked, you could go anywhere in the world, theoretically for a year. And my joke is usually it being Buffalo, New York, many people went and not that many people came back, which is actually really true. So I go to school in San Diego. And I had done an Asian philosophy course as a sophomore, and in all honesty, looking back, as far as I can tell, it was just kind of happenstance. There was a philosophy requirement. I had to do a philosophy course. I looked at that schedule, and I saw the Asian philosophy course, and it was convenient for me. I thought something like, oh, good, that's on Tuesday, you know. I'll take that one. And I did, and it completely changed my life. There were two things predominantly about that course that were so moving to me. One was, in talking about the Buddhist teaching, when I talked about the Buddha referring to life as having suffering, that suffering is an inevitable, intrinsic part of everyone's life. And despite that, on the surface seeming like kind of a pessimistic message, it was enormously liberating for me. Like many people, I'd had a very difficult, traumatic childhood, and like for many people, mine was a family system where this was never, ever spoken about. And so I felt tremendously isolated and kind of different, weirdly different from everybody else. And here was the Buddha saying right out loud, it's not just you. It's never just you. It's not that life is grim or horrible, but for everyone, it includes times of suffering. This is inevitable. This is the nature of things. And that was so enormous for me, because the implication is that instead of feeling isolated and aberrant and rejecting and bitter, we can seek one another in a way, because this is something that we share. We can experience these difficult times more in a sense of it being a part of life, we ourselves being a part of the human community, rather than feeling so cut off and alone. So that was huge. And then I heard in that class that there were tools. There were tools one could actually use to not only change our relationship to suffering, but change our relationship to everything. So, for example, how do we experience pleasure, the joy, the wonder, the beautiful things that come our way in life? Many times we're so distracted we don't even take them in. Or we have such a fixed idea of what should be happening, we don't really appreciate what is happening. So the story I often tell about that, now of course many years from that classroom, was I often have gone to Washington, D.C. to teach. And one year I was there during cherry blossom season, when you know there's this concentrated area with a lot of cherry trees and they all just kind of bloom. But I was so busy that year, I could only get there at night. Which was beautiful, but the following year, my friend, having heard I'd only got there at night, was determined I was gonna get there during the day. And we did it. We managed to get me there during the day, and I was just standing there and thought, this is so lovely. All these delicate pink blossoms, and so many of them, and it's so beautiful. And then my friend said, oh no, it's past the peak. And I thought, oh no, I'm having a bad experience. So we do that, right? And or we have a kind of distorted or funny relationship to pleasure because we're so afraid of losing it. As soon as it comes, we grab it. We try to be in control. We try to keep change from ever happening. So of course, that's a completely forlorn exercise because we never win, right? And or we relate to pleasure, to joy, to beauty. We don't really kind of take it in fully because we don't feel we deserve it. Either there's too much suffering in the world and it feels too selfish, in contrast to what really wisdom would show us is we need that lifting of our spirits in order to deal with the suffering, right? We need resilience, we need renewal. We need that as well, and we'll talk more about that later. Or we just feel it's too embarrassing almost. The story I often tell about that, it's not gonna be as impactful here in beautiful San Diego, but in one winter, often in the winter, and in fact this winter as well, I go to Maui to teach. Now, winter, I live in New England, that's, you know, the beginning of the story. And one year I was going, it was a miserable winter. icy, cold, snowy, treacherous. And I got to go to Maui in December. I was teaching with Ram Dass, who's an old friend of mine. He was at my very first meditation retreat in India in 1971. And Maui itself is like unearthly beauty. It's just, there are no words really for how beautiful it is. And the retreat is held in a resort, which is right on the ocean. So it's just like magnificent. So I got there and it was a retreat, right? So it was on my public schedule. But I did something extra, like I tweeted about it or something. And all of a sudden I started getting all these messages like, wow, you're on Maui. And I found myself writing back and saying, it's very humid here. It's like, it's not nearly as nice as you're imagining. It's very humid, you know? And I was so struck by my doing that, that I brought it up in the hall as part of a talk, like, look what we can do, you know? Why not like take it in and be grateful and feel it and, you know, let it be true instead of like, you know. And it sort of became like a theme of the retreat because I was leaving the meditation hall at one point and behind me was a friend and the now adult son of another friend. And he was saying to her, oh, my mom is like so bummed out. She really wanted to come to this retreat and she was so close to coming and right at the last minute she decided she couldn't come and she's so upset. And then I heard my friend say, did you tell her how humid it is here? You know? Right? So how do we relate to pleasure? It's a very compelling question. And certainly how do we relate to pain? To physical pain, to emotional pain, to the pain of feeling life torn asunder, being disconnected, adversity, all the things that are inevitable. They are so much a part of life. I think in so many ways, by and large in this country, the dominant conditioning is that we should be in control at all times. And that when things go awry, it's a sign of having lost control. And so with our own pain and difficulty, a very ready kind of conditioning or relationship is shame and fear and distress, extra distress and isolation. When it's the pain, the difficulty of others, we tend to want to isolate them, not to have to see it, not to be displeased or thrown off course by it. And so we can live in a tremendously isolated world and tremendously disconnected world. When we experience difficulty, when we experience adversity, it's not that it doesn't hurt. I'm thinking, things really can hurt. You know, I'm not the kind of person, or my belief system is not such that I believe that it's only our resistance that makes things, some things hurt. Or if we had a better attitude, or could only accept things fully, it wouldn't hurt. I say that sometimes it's gonna be on my epitaph, some things just hurt. Because I believe some things just hurt. And it is kind of cruel and unjust to expect of ourselves that they won't hurt. There can be tremendous tragedies in life where we could just be worn out, you know, from the kind of steady pressure of things not going well. Some things just hurt. But we are tremendously empowered in terms of how we relate to that pain. Are we adding what I would call kind of extra suffering, which we really don't need? And we might well be, just through sheer force of habit, not because we're bad people, not because we should know better and we don't, but it's just the force of habit. We can take what is already a difficult situation and it can become so much worse, which of course exhausts us. And we don't have the energy in that moment to deal with the pain that is genuinely there. And so it's very illuminating to look at our habits around feeling helpless, recognizing we're not getting what we want, we don't know what to do, something hurts in our bodies, our hearts hurt. You know, how are we with all of these feelings? Can we help create a kind of spacious holding of them, seeing as they unwind, as they unfold, what is also there? Can we relate gently with kindness towards some very difficult states we may be in without disparaging ourselves? You know, like, I've been meditating for 45 years, for God's sake, I shouldn't feel this anymore. Well, you know, I spent $10,000 in therapy just last year. You know, can we be with what we feel? That's what we feel. And can we also have the kind of creativity and interest and even discipline to look at what we might be adding onto it, which will only bring us down? Right? So it's not like it's because we're bad or anything, but because there is so much more potential, even in painful situations. Again, to find one another, to have a sense of connection, to let others help us. That isn't always so easy. To reach out to help someone else, to be that kind of reflective mirror towards somebody. Because if we can hang in there with our own feelings, we can hang in there with someone else's feelings too. To find what we can do, even if it feels like one small step, right? So the transformation comes not from pretending some things don't hurt, but from being different with that hurt, that hurting, which we have every ability to do. And then, back to my class a million years ago in Buffalo, New York. See why I need editors when I write. I also heard that even aside from the possibility of a complete transformation of how we relate to pleasure and a complete transformation of how we relate to pain, there's also a transformation of how we relate to neutral experience, the kind of ordinary, not very pleasant, not very painful, in between routine, repetitive moments of a day. Like, yeah, it's just another breath. Yeah. You know, it's like, yeah. Because those are the moments we tend to numb out. We go to sleep. We wait. There are very few of us whose attention is trained to subtlety. Most of us need intensity in order to feel alive, either intense pleasure or intense pain. And here too, the teaching was, there's a possibility of, instead of being in that old way, that same old way with neutral experience, you can change your relationship to that too and actually connect and have those kind of ordinary in between, seemingly nothing kind of times come alive for us. And I heard that there were tools to make it so. This wasn't just kind of a fond reflection, like, isn't it great? Buddha did this 2,500 years ago. Wow, you know? It's one of the settings where it's the most appropriate question, not selfish, not self-centered, not off the mark. The most appropriate question is, what about me? What about my mind? What about my life? That's really the crucial question. And I asked it. So I heard there were these tools called meditation. And those were practical, pragmatic means. They were actually tools that if you practice them, would change your life in all of those ways. Change the way we related to pleasure, to pain, to neutrality. It's a different life. And I looked around Buffalo, New York, and I didn't see it. Now, truly now, it's everywhere, of course. You know, I get all these invitations to like mindfulness conferences. Like, this is a long time ago. So I went to the Independent Study Department. And I said, I want to go to India to study meditation. And they said, write out the project proposal, which I did. And they accepted it. So off I went. So all credit to Buffalo, New York, and State University, which, and that class, which changed my entire life. So there are a few things in there. One is, this is about the practical methodology. It's not about a belief system. It's not about becoming something. It's not about rejecting anything else. This is said to be, these tools, these techniques, are said to be about what is believed to be a universal human capacity for understanding our lives instead of just living mechanically, for connecting instead of being so cut off, for caring, for love, for compassion, no matter what we may have gone through as individuals. This capacity, this potential, is said to always be there. And in fact, in Buddhist traditions, the Buddha is always talked about as having been a human being. He was a human being who had some very deep questions about the nature of life. And any answers he came to about suffering, about relief from suffering, he came to through the power of his own awareness, and so can we, whatever our own questions are. So when we look at a Buddha statue, it said we're really looking at a human potential, a manifestation or an embodiment of human potential, to love that completely, to understand that deeply. And so we're looking at a Buddha statue to see that potential inside ourselves. Right, so we look at the Buddha to see ourselves, and it's not just like me and the Buddha, you know, we're fine. It's the rest of you who are really, you know. It's not like that. We look at ourselves on that level, that potential, that capacity, which may be covered over, usually is, may be hard to find, it may be hard to trust, but it said it could never, ever be destroyed. We look at ourselves on that level and we discover everybody else because it's a universal capacity. And so we look at the Buddha to see ourselves. We look at ourselves that deeply and we see all beings everywhere. That's why he's sitting up here, right? So I went off to India. I was 18 years old. I'd never even been to California before. Shocking. And I had a very particular desire or intention, which was not, you know, philosophical or religious. I really wanted to learn those tools. I wanted to know the how-to. So it took a while to find the situation which really was about that, and I finally did in the context of an intensive 10-day retreat. I went into that retreat, never having meditated for one single second before in my life, and I began. And the technique I was given, we're gonna do together in a few minutes, and then just hang out together and have some discussion. The techniques of that retreat and the techniques I began with were really all around mindfulness. Mindfulness is considered a relational process. It's changing the way we relate to our bodies, our minds, our emotions, pleasure, pain, neutrality, that's what it's about. At the very end of that retreat, I heard the word metta, M-E-T-T-A, for the first time. Metta is the Pali word usually translated as loving kindness. And it moved me a lot, but I didn't really get to deeply practice it. Those of you, some of you have probably done courses with SN Goenka or in that style, know that the loving kindness is almost the ceremonial way you say goodbye. It's like you do it for an hour and then it's over. It's like a ritual, sort of. There's tremendous loving kindness implicit in the mindfulness. Otherwise, we would just be judging all the time, right? All these various experiences would be coming up and we would be holding on or pushing away, So there's always implicit loving kindness. There's always implicit self-compassion in meditation. The technique we're gonna do together is the one I started with, which is kind of the foundational exercise of just sitting and being with your breath, feeling your breath. So that was the first technique I ever learned. Goenka said, sit down and feel your breath. And first of all, I was really disappointed. I thought, feel my breath? I came all the way to India, you know? Where's the magical, esoteric, fantastic technique? It's gonna change my whole life. And then I thought, how hard can this be? And it was like, whoa. It's not so easy. I thought, okay, what'll it be like? 800 breaths or 900 breaths before my mind starts to wander. And to my astonishment, it was like one breath, you know? And I was gone. It was like, and way gone. So, this is the common experience. Clearly, we feel a few breaths and we're just sucked into something. And then comes the magic moment where we realize, oh, it's been quite some time since I last felt a breath. That's an enormous moment, because our usual habit would be to judge ourselves and berate ourselves and put ourselves down and feel like a failure. And instead, we have the chance to let go gently and begin again with some self-compassion, right? Some kindness toward ourselves. This is actually revolutionary. Even if those words are never used, that's the only way to be able to let go and begin again, is through deepening self-compassion. So that's another way. It's kind of happening implicitly all along. There are ways that loving kindness and qualities like compassion are developed through insight, through seeing the world much more as it actually is. You know what it's like when you have like a whole big trip about somebody and you're sure you know who they are? And then maybe something happens and you find out something about them, or you see a kind of vulnerability, or something happens. So that rigid, certain view of them dissolves or breaks apart, and you go, oh, that actually wasn't the whole story of who you are. Let's look at the reality. In those moments, we feel a quality of connection that is genuine. It's sort of like that, except on a vaster scale. Because what we discovered just from paying attention, from really being mindful, is that we do live in an interconnected universe. That this isn't sentimental, it isn't fanciful, this isn't like poetry. This is how things are. Our lives are intertwined, we're interdependent. Science shows us this these days, economics shows us this, environmental consciousness certainly shows us this. Even epidemiology shows us this. You know, what happens over there doesn't nicely stay over there. It ripples out over here. And what we do, where we put our energy, our convictions, it matters. It ripples out. We simply live in an intertwined, interdependent, interconnected universe. So how do we respond to that? The heart's response to that is a sense of caring, not fixing and not being in charge, but actually caring. My friend Bob Thurman, who's a professor of Buddhist studies at Columbia University, uses this example all the time. He says, imagine you're on a subway and these Martians come and they zap the subway car so that those of you who are there are going to be together forever. So he says, what do you do? You know, if somebody's hungry, you feed them. If somebody's freaking out, you try to calm them down. Not because you necessarily like them or you approve of them, but because you're going to be together forever. Our lives have something to do with one another. Well, guess what? It's kind of true. So insight, wisdom, clear seeing, listening will bring us a sense of loving kindness. And there are practices that we can do that will, that are kind of devoted to the deepening of qualities like loving kindness and compassion. And those are practices which I call like a stretch. They're practices that acknowledge we have maybe a certain rut, a certain way of paying attention, and we're willing to stretch just to see what happens when we pay attention differently. So, for example, if you go to my website or this website called Happify, you'll see one of the world's cutest things, which is an animation that Happify.com made of, I went into a recording studio and I told some stories and they made animations out of two of them. So the first one is the one I'm talking about, which I do think is one of the cutest things in the world. Every character in the animation is a dog. So you see this dog's mouth moving and my voice is coming out. It's really cute. And it's about compassion. So the story is that even though I live in Massachusetts, I've often had a sublet apartment in New York City, and I had one year in a certain neighborhood. And I have a friend who's a writer who, at that time, was living in that same neighborhood. So one day he showed me the manuscript of his forthcoming book, in which he tells the story of very often going into the grocery store, the neighborhood grocery store, and seeing the same woman working behind the cashier, you know, behind the counter very, very often, and not really having a sense of her, kind of maybe a vague sense that maybe she was a little bit unhappy or grim, but he realized he basically never paid any attention to her. And that, as he put it in the book, for all I recognized, she was a living, breathing human being who wanted to be happy just as I do. She might as well have been a cash register with arms. And he was so appalled at himself for, in effect, looking right through her or discounting her that he resolved to go into the store and pay absolute, complete attention to her. And he did that, and he said, he wrote, you know, the first thing he noticed was that she was singing along to something playing on the radio, and that she had an exquisitely beautiful voice. So he said to her, wow, you have an incredibly beautiful voice. And she lit up and she gave him this big radiant smile. So I was reading all that and I thought, wow, I go into that same store all the time and I don't really pay any attention to her either. I just have the vaguest sense of her, and maybe she is like a little bit unhappy or something, but I thought, okay, I know. I can't really go into the store and say, I read you have a really beautiful voice, because that's like really bizarre. But I can go into the store and say, I heard you have a really beautiful voice, because that might happen, right? It could come up in conversation. So I thought, okay, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go into the store and say, I heard you have a really beautiful voice. And she's going to light up and give me this big radiant smile. I'm going to make her so happy. So I went into the store, and the first thing I noticed was she was already smiling radiantly. And I thought, oh, all right. You know. And I realized in that moment, I didn't have a clue. I mean, she could have been a perfectly happy person, and evidently so. And I caught one glimpse of her one day, you know, and fixed that in my mind. That's who she is. So the animation goes on to talk about how compassion grows from paying attention. It's not like we try to force out a feeling we don't have or pretend, but we learn to pay attention differently. That's the stretch. Who do we look through instead of at? Who do we have those fixed ideas, not based on reality? And can we look more completely? So those are the kinds of questions, and that becomes a training, actually, in loving kindness and compassion. So the last thing I'll say about that is that I would say there are two major controversies I've experienced in all these years of teaching loving kindness techniques. One is the idea that those qualities of the heart make us weak. They make us kind of stupid. That if you practice having a loving heart, it necessarily dictates a certain kind of action, like saying yes, being sweet, giving them your money, letting them get away with it, not standing on your own principles, letting other people be hurt, letting yourself be abused, right? Whereas it doesn't mean any of that at all. It's not a weakness, really. It's a tremendous force. It's a tremendous strength. Because it's true. Our lives do have something to do with one another. And so part of the exploration is seeing the tremendous strength that comes from the power of love, which it really is. And the other great controversy is the idea that these qualities are trainable. And I understand it sounds weird, you know, like I went and did a weekend workshop and I came out compassionate or something, you know. It does sound cold or mechanistic, but it's not about that. It's really understanding the tremendous role of awareness or attention, and that we have so much possibility to pay attention differently, which will bring many, many things, including connection, clarity, loving kindness, compassion. And we know we can train attention because that's exactly what meditation practice is. So there's a great deal in our hands, even as we experience the winds of change and so many things happening in our lives, that potential for transformation really does lie with what we do with our own minds and our own awareness. Okay, you want to stretch for a minute, and we'll do some sitting, and then we'll just hang out. I understand there are like four different kinds of meditation groups that meet right in this amazingly wonderful space. So it's pretty great. And I want to guide us through a sitting, which, as I said, is like a foundational technique. And by foundational, I think sometimes we in the West tend to think in such linear terms that foundational sounds like something, it's like 101, you know, and you do it a little bit and you never do it again because you're beyond it. But it's not like that. We always come back to it because it's like fundamental, you know, and we just keep coming back and coming back. And I would say, you know, these, for many of us, these are very, very stressful times. There's a lot of difficulty, there's a lot of tension, there's a lot of uncertainty, and these are times when having some kind of personal practice is such a tremendous refuge. Any time really is. And I often say to people, they say, you know, it's so boring, like, nothing much is happening. And I say, this is like strength training. You know, do it in the boring times, because there will be times that aren't so boring, when you probably will really need it. So whatever one's individual practice feels like, and sometimes it feels really peaceful, sometimes it feels very restless, it doesn't matter. It's like the doing of it, day by day, is really like that strength training. And I've just been with all these neuroscientists, you know, and people, and it's a little bit of a funny conversation, but, you know, the race is on to discover the dose response. Like, basically the question is, as I put it, this is America. Everybody wants to know what's the least amount of time I can put into this thing and still have my brain change the way it says in the newspaper. Your brain will change, right? All the good ways we want our brains to change. And I say, you know, I don't know how healthy it is to go for the bare minimum. But a lot of people are considering that. They have it down to like 9 minutes a day, honestly. But every day, right? So it can be a fun thought. It can't be something you think your cousin should do or your partner, and you never do yourself. It's the doing of it, and the doing of it, and the doing of it, that makes the difference. And so it's really an invitation and a plea. If you're moved to experiment with these things, it has to be like a real experiment. You know, you have to put it into practice. And that's not to say you never assess or evaluate. I mean, of course we do. You don't want to do something forever, not knowing if it's bringing you any benefit. But try not to evaluate every single second, because then you're not actually doing it, you're just evaluating it. And when you do, let's say you say, I'm going to try it for a month, something like that. I'm going to try it every day for a month, or whatever's realistic for you. When you do sort of try to look at, is it making any difference, you have to look at your life itself, not at that, say, 9 or 10 minute period each day when you're formally sitting, because that may not even change, honestly, in all honesty, but you will find a lot of difference in the way you treat yourself when you've made a mistake, how you meet a stranger, how you meet an adversary, how you meet adversarial conditions, which is where it counts. Like, I have a friend, he was in particular talking about loving kindness meditation, but it could be another. He said to me once, he took me out to lunch in New York, and he said, this is like a confessional lunch. So I said, okay. And he said, I have to confess that I've been practicing for 3 years doing loving kindness meditation each day, whether I'm on retreat or not. And I don't see that much difference in my experience sitting now than it was 3 years ago when I began. But he said, I'm like a different person. He said, I'm different with myself, I'm different with my family, I'm different ethically, I'm different with my community. And then he looked at me and he said, is that enough? And I said, yeah, you know, I kind of think that's enough. But we tend to look at that 10-minute period or 20-minute period like, you know, is it splendid yet, you know? And it may not be, but it doesn't matter. right? So it's those two things. I really urge you to, if you're interested, think about trying to put it into practice every day. And then when you're trying to figure out if you want to continue, look at your life as the basis for that, okay? So we're going to sit together. I'm going to guide you through it. See if you can sit comfortably. You want some energy in your body, so you want your back straight, but not like so much energy you're really stiff and uptight. You also want to be relaxed and at ease, but not like so at ease your waist slumped over, right? So you feel your way into what seems like a balanced posture for you. And you can close your eyes or not, however you feel most comfortable. If you get really sleepy with your eyes closed, it's fine to open your eyes and you can continue on. Sometimes even before we get to the breath, we just start by listening to sound. Whether it's the sound of my voice or other sounds, it's a way of relaxing deep inside, allowing our experience to come and go. Of course we like some sounds and we don't like others, but we don't have to chase after them to hold on or push away. Let them come, let them go. It's like the sounds wash through you. And bring your attention to the feeling of your body sitting, whatever sensations you discover. Bring your attention to your hands. And see if you can make the shift from the more conceptual level, like of fingers, to the world of direct sensation. Picking up pulsing, throbbing, pressure, whatever it might be. You don't have to name these things, but feel them. And bring your attention to the feeling of your breath. And this system is just the normal, natural breath. You don't have to try to make it deeper or different. Just however the breath is appearing. And see if you can find the place where the breath is strongest for you or clearest for you. Maybe that's the nostrils or the chest or the abdomen. Find that place, bring your attention there, and just rest. See if you can feel one breath. Without concern for what's already gone by, without leaning forward for even the very next breath. And if you like, you can use a quiet mental notation, like in, out, or rising, falling, to help support the awareness of the breath, but very quiet. So your attention's really going to feeling the breath, one breath at a time. If images or sounds or sensations or emotions should arise, but they're not all that strong, if you can stay connected to the feeling of the breath, you can let them flow on by. It's okay, you're breathing. It's just one breath. But if something comes up and it is strong, it just pulls you away, you get lost in thought, spun out in a fantasy, or you fall asleep, truly don't worry about it. The most important moment is the next moment, after you've been gone, after you've been lost. The moment when you realize time to let go gently and begin again with kindness towards yourself. We let go and we begin again, and we let go and we begin again. If you have to do that like 10 billion times, in the next few minutes, that's actually totally fine. It's kind of a nice thing to do every day. We have time for some questions or comments, just discussion, hanging out. Some really kind people are going to run around with microphones, which I think you really need to use.
Hi.
Okay.
My question is about, is there a point in your practice where you want to stop watching the breath, or is it something that fades away after you have practiced for a long time? And I guess what I'm saying is the breath another tool to help with your practice, and eventually with time, does it sort of fade away, or?
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of like there are different ways of using the breath as an anchor for attention. One is really for a kind of greater stability of attention, so that's what we did, where when something else comes up, you pretty well want to let go of it and come back, let go of it and come back. And over time, that really reinforces the strength of our concentration, right? And there's a kind of, usually we're pretty scattered, you know, not maybe all day long, but some chunk of the day, our attention's flying off into the past, or flying off into the future, not in useful ways, which it could be, but more in useless kind of ways. You know, endless rumination about something in the past we can't change. And anxious speculation about something in the future, and we don't know if it's going to turn out that way. You know, what if my plane is late? Oh no, I bet it's going to be late. What's that going to mean? It's going to mean I'm going to miss my connection. Oh no, what's that going to mean? You know, like, it's like a week away, you know, like, you know, but just like. So the first benefit of concentration is said to be like power, because that's a lot of energy that is just scattered all over the place. And as we gather it together, it becomes available to us. So we're kind of empowered by that. And there's also a sort of integrative function that happens, is almost like parts of ourselves come together, and we have a sense of being centered or more grounded, more whole. You know, and so that is just using the breath the way we did, just coming back. There are other ways, which is really more a kind of broader mindfulness approach, where the breath is just the beginning. That's just the initial object. And then when something else arises, if it's strong enough, not like a little dwippy thing, you know, but strong sensation, strong emotion, that becomes the object of meditation. You're not trying to just let go and come back to the breath. You're paying full attention to the emotion, you know, in a certain way, not like, why is it here and what am I going to do about it, but what does it feel like in my body? And what's the, let's say it's anger, you know, like what's the anger movie? Maybe if we sit with anger and just sit with it, paying attention to it, we see a lot of sadness, we see a lot of fear. You know, we just see a constellation of things within there, and we also see that it's changing. It's constantly moving and changing. You know, so you might spend very little time with the breath in that second way of practice, but we do keep coming back to it just to kind of settle, and then something else, you know. So that's another way the breath could be used. Or you may not use the breath at all. You could use some other object that's that centering object. So this is just it's like one possibility, you know, amongst many. Got to work.
Okay. So first, I want to thank you. I found your voice very calming and soothing and grounding, and I really appreciated the space that you held for us. I benefited greatly. And my question is any and all styles and forms of meditation as effective as any other?
Is any style of meditation as effective as any other? There probably is no broad answer for that. It's probably very personal. So, for example, the breath is a common tool to use. It's a common object to use is that centering object. For one thing, as my early teachers would say, you don't have to believe anything to feel your breath, right? You don't have to call yourself a Buddhist or a Hindu or reject anything else. If you're breathing, you could be meditating. And then as one teacher went on to say, the breath is very portable, which is true, you know? So if you practice, let's say, 10 minutes in the morning and you use the breath as the object to kind of come back to yourself, then you're at work. And it's like some crazy, chaotic scene, and there's all this anxiety in the room. You can just like take a few breaths and center. And one of the things I love about that is that it's completely private. Like, nobody has to know you're doing it, right? It's not like weird. You're just like, all right, it's our own. It's very personal. It's very private. So that's the kind of reasoning why the breath is so often used. But the breath doesn't work for everybody. You know, there are physical reasons why the breath may not work as a good object that way. There are emotional reasons, you know, like there could be a lot of emotion tied up with those areas where we breathe or whatever, with the breath itself. And so then there are alternatives. You know, something else in your body or a rotation of touch points or listening to sound or, you know, so... It's one of the benefits of being able to work with a teacher if you can, or just experimenting and seeing what might suit you. Languaging can be different. Context can be different. Some people, walking meditation is a really good form of meditation for some people. Some days, you know, it's the best thing to do. So I kind of like when people have a chance to experiment with a bunch of forms, and then you can see.
First of all, thank you for doing this and for just all of your work as a whole. Then I just have like 1.5 questions. First off, do you think like a concentration practice and an insight practice can kind of be combined into one? And then also metta, as a whole, do you think it kind of leads to insight of like emptiness and impermanence and all of that fun stuff, aka liberation? So,
yes, I think the first question, concentration and insight practice can be combined. Certainly, at certain levels, in that. My teacher's teacher was Mahasi Sayadaw, who was a Burmese monk, one of my teacher's teachers. It was a Burmese monk at the turn of the last century, who really worked a lot with building concentration through a continuity of awareness. You know, so if you're on retreat in that style, the amount of mindfulness you had getting up from your sitting was as significant as anything that might have happened in the sitting. And working with my own teacher, who was a Burmese monk also, named Sayadaw Upandita, there were days when we would meet every day, and again, this is in the context of intensive retreat, when instead of being able to describe my sitting meditation or my walking meditation to him, which were the two formal styles we were going back and forth and back and forth doing, he would look at me and he'd say, tell me everything you noticed when you drank a cup of tea, which was nothing. So I'd leave, and I'd sit, and I'd walk, and I'd drink tea really mindfully. Then I'd go back in the next day and he'd say, tell me everything you noticed when you washed your face, which was nothing. So I sat and I walked and I drank tea really mindfully in case he went back to that. And then when I washed my face, I felt my hands in the water and I felt the water on my face, you know. So they were kind of known for that. In effect, developing a concentration through a continuity of mindfulness rather than a very long period of having a single object. So it's just stylistic, you know, in doing that. Now, we can't necessarily live that way all day, you know, at home, but what that translates to for us is what a venerable old Tibetan teacher once described as short moments many times. So in addition to, you know, the 15 minutes, 20 minutes a day, whatever it is that you're gonna sit every day or walk every day in a dedicated way, short moments many times. Don't always be multitasking, maybe. Maybe drink a cup of tea without checking your email at the same time, right? Or without checking your email, being on a conference call and having the TV on mute while you're reading the crawl at the same time. Just drink the cup of tea. You know, so these are the kinds of things that are not so lengthy that they're gonna blow up our to-do list, but they actually make a difference to punctuate the day. Short moments many times, it makes a difference. So people almost like ritualize that. You know, that's where like what started with Thich Nhat Hanh, which is a pretty common piece of advice now, like don't pick up the phone on the first ring, let it ring three times and breathe. Then you pick it up. I still maintain what I really believe is the efficacy of daily formal practice, because I think that's what helps us remember when we hear the phone ring. It's not hard to do, but it's hard to remember, like in the middle of a, you know, pressured situation. But if you've sat that morning, you're so much more likely to remember. And there's just these moments that are like respites, you know, that are very important. So, in terms of loving kindness practice being a wisdom practice, I don't think it actually is. It is a concentration practice, classically. It's not to say wisdom is never developed. And there's a kind of wisdom, not so much about change, but more about interconnection. I mean, you really do see the dissolution of kind of rigidly held barriers, which is the interconnection is the other side of emptiness. You know, because emptiness doesn't mean vacuity or blankness. It means nothing is independent of causes and conditions, right? So when you start thinking of causes and conditions, you're looking at interconnection. So the example would be, for example, if you go out and look at a tree, there's a way of seeing the tree and it's just this thing there, right? It's just an entity that is there. And that's a valid way of seeing it on a certain level. But there's another way of looking at the tree and sensing the soil, which is nourishing it, and everything that affects the quality of the soil, which is like the rainfall, right? And what affects the quality of the rainfall? These days, we know there are so many conditions, really widespread, that affect the quality of the rainfall. That's a part of the tree, too, and the sunlight and the moonlight and, you know, who planted the tree there. And so there's a way of looking at the tree, and you see it's like a network of connections. That's also true. And it's on that level that we begin to see we see interconnection, we also see emptiness. And actually, we'll do an exercise right now, which is my very favorite exercise, kind of prompted by that. So there is a kind of wisdom on that particular thing, but I don't know that, I mean, it's not designed to help you see the minutely changing nature of everything. It's not a bad thing to do, however. No, it's a very useful thing to do. Okay, so here's our exercise for a few moments, our reflection. As you sit here, just see who comes to mind in terms of anyone who has played any role at all in the fact that you're sitting here right now. Right? Because very likely no one was driving by and just had the thought, I think I'll go in there. Right? We're all here because of conversations we had with people. Somebody gave us a book. Somebody told us about their meditation practice. Somebody told us about this organization. Somebody told us about this facility. So who comes to mind? Sometimes I do this reflection and I think about the Board of Regents of the state of New York, which gave out scholarships for people to go to schools within the state, which is how I was able to go to college, which is how I ended up in India, because they're part of why I'm sitting here right now too. And sometimes I do that reflection and I think about those people whose actions have really hurt me, not just the ones I find annoying, but those times when I really have felt like I was at an edge and that I knew something had to change within me or I wouldn't be free. I couldn't go on in that same way because they're a part of why I'm sitting here right now too. So what is this moment in time? We're all here because of a confluence of interactions, relationships, connections. Every moment in time is like that. So from that, we can sense there's no solid, like, in control, separate thing, you know? But really just this pattern of connectedness. Okay, I'm so glad we got to do my favorite reflection. Yeah. Who has a microphone? Yeah.
So many different kinds of meditation practices are around me. My Chinese friend tells me there's something called Chen in China, but I don't understand it. Is that a form of meditation?
Is what?
Chen. It's not my real question is this. If Consumer Reports.
Is there a Consumer Reports for meditation?
Yeah, wouldn't that be nice? You know, they could say, we actually put to the laboratory, you know, using MRIs and neuroscience, this form and this form and this form. And they'd probably end up with a list that would say, well, if you're this age group and sex, and you know, then you should try this one, but for this. There must be scientific 21st century ways of checking out some of these things. Can you tell us?
Well, I tell you, I know scientists who want that. I mean, they want to create that. Not so much about age and gender, but more about, you know, do you have an inclination to be anxious, or do you have an inclination to be depressed, or do you have, you know, they very much want to create that. I have my doubts, in all honesty. Stanford might be doing that because they have a wonderful program about compassion. It's called C-Care. I'm not sure what it all stands for. One of the C's is compassion, but I don't know. There is a big push, like a lot of people want that. I guess I'm more old-fashioned than that, maybe just older than that, in that there's such a complex of conditions around someone's practice. Do you have a supportive group? What are they like? Do you have a teacher? What are they like? I'm not sure there's going to be sort of a diagnostic manual that's going to say, this is for that and this is for that. I mean, to some extent that exists, like even within the Buddhist teaching, but the order in which you do things and the nature of it. So, for example, loving kindness was taught as the antidote to fear by the Buddha, they say. This is the story anyway, right? So if you find yourself very fearful, it's probably a good idea to explore loving kindness practice. Doesn't mean mindfulness in itself will do nothing, but that's the theory. This is the direct opposite. It's the direct antidote. But it's not so that in every case you're going to have like great loving kindness teacher around, or you know, you can do it in technology these days. You can do it with an app, but maybe you don't like those things, or you know, who knows? And so to say that the loving kindness meditation is the thing for you seems a little limited, right? When you have like a fantastic ability to study mindfulness with someone in a really supportive group. And I mean, I also say about myself, I'm the kind of person who really is benefited by structure, which is partly why I say sit every day, because I'm really talking to myself. Like if I were to try to sit 3 times a week, it wouldn't be that good. You know, Monday would come around and I'd say, you know, Monday's a hard day. Maybe I should start on Wednesday. Wednesday comes around, I'd say, you know, if I did it 3 times over the weekend, surely that, right? But if I know it's like every day, that helps me. I'm just, not everyone's like me, right? But that helps me and people like me. So, you know, if the scenario exists that's really supportive of your particular needs, that is not like on the, you know, it's not the line item, I would suggest you do what's supportive.
I have a question that's, I guess, more of a curiosity. A number of friends have asked me, why are we breathing in the nose and out the mouth?
Why are we?
Well,
we're not.
Commonly, I've been asked to meditate that way.
Well, I mean, it's true there are some schools, and particularly yogic schools, that are very much about kind of doing specific things with the breath, you know, breathing in one nostril and breathing out the other or whatever. But in this style of practice, we're not. I mean, it's really however the breath is natural. And my own teachers would often make that point. They'd say, it's not a breathing exercise, it's an awareness exercise. You know, but some people get a lot of benefit out of a particularly like stylized kind of breath. It's just a different system. Yeah.
Hello. Meditation came out of Buddhism.
Where are you?
I'm right here. And a lot of people...
Meditation came out of what?
Buddhism. Okay. And a lot of people in the world, different countries these days, are meditating. Okay. I'm supposed to stand up. Could you say something about the relationship between meditation and religion? Or do you find it better to try to keep things separate?
Okay, so I wouldn't say meditation came out of Buddhism. I'd say these methods of meditation came out of Buddhism. There are plenty of other methods of meditation in every other religion or faith tradition. And some of them are similar, some of them are very different. One of the things that's happened for these particular methods of meditation is that in a lot of ways they have been spun off from, sometimes, not always, from the kind of Buddhist teachings or tradition. I mean, I'm sitting next to a Buddha, but that isn't always the case, you know? And they lend themselves to that because, like I said, it's like, you know, the breath is universal. it's not like chanting the name of God as you know them or something like that, right? So there are certain stylistic things about these techniques that really allow them to be explored without the kind of philosophical context. My first teacher, as I said, was S.N. Goenka. In that intensive 10-day retreat and the first night of the retreat, so these are practically the first words I heard about it, he said, the Buddha did not teach Buddhism. The Buddha taught a way of life. So it's in no way about becoming a Buddhist. It's about a certain way of life. Bravo. Now, a further controversy these days is that the methods have been spun off away from that way of life, often. You know, so there may not be a lot of discussion about ethics, although there should be, or there could be, within the broader application of the teachings. It's not meant to be just like an exercise, but really we look at how we speak to our neighbors, we look at how we speak to our children, we look at everything, you know? And so it's not clear cut, even that, because within Buddhist teaching there have been strands that have believed forever. You could almost say they believe so strongly in the innate goodness of people that they say, okay, if you start with just being more aware, you're more mindful, then you see things more clearly. The more clearly you see things, the more your behavior will change. You know, it's like, and it's true. It's like you sit in meditation and some lie you told 15 years ago comes up, and you think, oh my God, you know, like, first of all, that's still there. And look at how terrible that feels. That's a big learning, you know, and it's not because you're intending to do that. You'd much rather it didn't come up. But it just happens in the course of events, and that's a lesson. You know what? Our actions are consequential. Our speech is consequential. Things don't just nicely disappear. If we sort of behave in certain ways, it actually hurts, right? So a commitment to be more truthful comes out of that. That's also true. So it just depends on the kind of the sequence or what you believe about that sequence. But I don't think the meditation needs to be religious, you know, held in a religious context. I never have, you know.
Good for you.
Sharon, I have.
Where are you? Wave your hands. Oh, yeah. It's probably a parable in that.
Meditation, one of the consequences in change of your behavior that you don't expect, it's spontaneous, you're nicer to people, this happens, and it happens. Another consequence that's happened, and that is that you get answers to some of your repressed problems that you've had in your life. And these answers don't necessarily come in the midst of meditation. I want you to comment on when the answers come in dreams. When you dream, I mean, I've had with a person I have troubles with all the time, and I keep loving kindness to that person, loving kindness. And then eventually, the miracle, that I have a dream where I actually see that person in my dream and speak to her, and she speaks to me, and we feel, and I wake up feeling so good about that person. That dream level, could you talk a little bit about that? Because I've learned a lot from, after meditating, from the dreams that come a day or two or maybe a week later.
Did you hear that? The question or the comment was about as we go more deeply into meditation, we also find kind of resolutions to maybe some long-standing old problems, but not necessarily while we're meditating, maybe when we're dreaming,
you know, which was beautiful.
And I think that's absolutely true because our lives are all of one piece. and that we may uncover certain things or come to a kind of clarity or whatever. And it may be when we're dreaming. It may be when we're just, you know, taking a walk or doing something else. It isn't necessarily contained in that period. And dreaming, of course, is especially interesting because so much can happen. I always used to be grateful in the early days of my practice, it was very much sort of a purification model. The idea was that many things would come up, and this was good. Many painful things might come up, and that's also good. And so if I had a really, you know, nightmarish kind of dream with a lot of stuff happening, I would think, at least I got to lie down during it, you know, like, and get some rest, and it was just kind of coming out. That's really good. Yeah, I mean, I don't understand how to analyze dreams or, you know, like anything or what it all means, but yeah. Yeah, well, I hope it comes. It's good.
And it's, I need a lot of help with this. It's the elephant in the room. I've had very good experience, loving kindness for the other, for the enemy. That person was someone I knew, someone I had a relationship with. I don't know how to describe my current enemy in Washington and what's going on. I don't know this person or phenomenon or group of people. I want to use loving kindness in some way.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how to balance that with compassionate use of force or other things that also
mm-hmm.
are there for me and neutral and people I love, everyone else except the enemy.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, I think it's a holistic picture. I mean, even when I was speaking about allowing oneself to enjoy pleasure, you know, and getting kind of a respite from that, I think that plays into it. In some ways, the most important thing might be loving kindness for oneself right now. And even that kind of allowing of oneself to sort of get a break and have a sense of restoring could be very important. And then I would, you know, just really think about what something like loving kindness means to you. Because to the degree it means, as classically it meant, the antidote to fear, then that makes sense, right? To the degree that it means, and it often does just because of conventional understanding and the way we use language, to the degree that it starts to mean giving in or not caring or wishing somebody succeeded hurting other people or, you know, not maybe that graphic, but, you know, just the sense of losing one's own clarity about what we feel is right or wrong. You know, and it's also an exploration, which is really important, about what strengthens us and what weakens us. Because the kind of rigid demarcation of somebody as an enemy compared to an adversary tends to be a very weakening reality. You know, it's not actually giving us the energy to go forward and do whatever, I mean, you know, appears as something that might be helpful to someone, you know, in this time. but it comes from our own clear seeing. You know, because I think it's not persuasive for somebody to say, you know, we should all love one another and come together, you know, in some way that isn't real. You know, it's just not, it's not persuasive, because it implies, I think, to any reasonable person, like, give up what you believe in and just give in, and that's not that attractive, you know? But if we look at what hatred does and enmity does and corrosive fear does, and it's also not that helpful in the end. You know, people burn out. You can't go on in a sustained effort toward anything from that place. And so, but I think that exploration is more important than the practice, actually, in that sense, right now. You know, is really take a deep look at the nature of different reactions and what they feel like and what they seem to give us and what they seem to take away, and decide where you want to go. Because then if it's in the direction of loving kindness from that understanding, then you just practice. And it can feel ridiculous sometimes, but you just do it. And you do it for everybody. Okay, two more.
Also, a little bit of a different question about metta, and I know you said it wasn't maybe part of a wisdom practice, but how would you see us, maybe not this week, because this week's a different deal, but in more calm times, how do you see us integrating metta into our practice? A few minutes a day, or instead of our practice sometimes, or...
It's really up to you. You know, like I did mindfulness practice for like 14 years or something before I had the chance to learn metta practice in a systematic, guided way. Then I went to Burma for 3 months and I did it for 3 months. And that was the beginning of a 4-year period where it was my only practice. I just did metta. It was a really nice time. And then I went back through the strict instructions of my teacher to doing mindfulness practice. And so there are periods when I do both. You know, different sittings, different techniques. They'll help each other. They're not going to take away from one another. And then there are periods where... like more recently, when I sit every day, I do sit every day. It's really a mindfulness practice, but I have a commitment, I have a resolve to do metta, to do loving kindness anytime I'm waiting, and I count every mode of transportation as waiting. So airplanes, buses, taxis, walking down the streets of New York, you know, rather than kind of waste time or be fretful or whatever, I actually do loving kindness practice silently. And it makes a big difference. It's fun, it's warm, connected, you know. One of the things I like is that all the same judgments might arise, they do arise in my mind, but I can cap them with a little bit of loving kindness, like, why are you wearing that jacket? Be happy, you know. Like that. And I would think, you know, this is a stressful time. It's a time of fear and, you know, so many things, that more loving kindness rather than less is a pretty good idea. Yes.
I've been listening to you, and I'm not where I was when I raised my hand. But... But I want to say that in the 70s, I was a pacifist, and I was deeply disappointed by learning that through the process of marching, that I was the enemy. I was just as aggressive in certain ways as everyone else. So then I went into graduate school and went on and learned a lot more about myself. That's not always pleasant, and sometimes it is. But coming to 2001 and 9/11, I again realized I had to do a serious practice. I knew our country would set up a war. I knew that there would be more turmoil than there had been for years. And I just want to say I'm so grateful that my spirituality and my insightfulness has led me to such a wonderful point from these kinds of work with you, the Dalai Lama work, and others. Now I even heard what a friend we have in Jesus, because my brother-in-law died this week. And I understand that so differently. I understand that we need a place for our burdens to be carried for us. So I want to thank you, and I'm glad you're here.
Thank you. Thanks so much. Thank you. Okay, thank you. Thank you all so much. This is really a really wonderful thing. You're going to make some announcements, right?
Yeah, real quick.
Do you want to come up, or are you going to
crouch
where you are? Okay.
Okay. So my name is Irene Folk, and I'm on the board of directors with Insight San Diego. And first and foremost, I wanted to thank Sharon for coming. What a gift this is after the emotional week and even months that we've all had. No matter where you stand, I think we're probably all suffering from a little PTSD, and or maybe TSD, you know, it might not be post, but but I just wanted to, I'll make this really quick. I wanted to thank Sharon. I wanted to thank the volunteers with Insight San Diego for help pulling this off so smoothly. And I wanted to thank the Unitarian Church for having us. We've been here for a couple months now, and they have been incredibly welcoming and gracious, even when we felt like we were kind of taking over, like today. And lastly, to all of you for showing up. You know, my thought, you know, I have these worst case scenarios in my head, and my thought was, you know what, even if Sharon doesn't show up, the fact that this many people are coming together to practice metta on a Sunday afternoon, or to, you know, to practice looking at our minds and into our hearts, is just so moving. And just a few quick statements about Insight San Diego. We've had our doors open for a little over 2 years now. It was kind of like we opened our doors and people just flooded in, almost like, you know, it's about time. You know, it's like somebody just said to me earlier, I hadn't seen her in a while, and she said, you guys have been really busy. And I said, we're just scrambling to keep up, because the community is already here, and they're hungry for the Dharma, and that's really moving to me. And so please, if you're not familiar with us, go on our website. I can't even, you know, it would take too much time to announce all the groups and events that we have coming up. We're at insightsd.org. We are a peer-led and peer-organized organization, and so we don't, we're based on your generosity and your kindness. So if you can support us financially, there's a couple of donables back there, one for us and UU, and another one for Sharon, who had, in addition to the week and the months that we've had, spent the weekend at the Mind Life Conference, and I'm sure it was a very exhausting but probably exhilarating weekend. And please show your appreciation to her for extending her weekend. And lastly, we could really use not just your financial support, but, you know, volunteers. Like I said, we're, you know, peer run. And so if you're interested in getting involved at that, in that kind of way, please go on our website, and there's a contact number that you can just, you know, let us know. And lastly, as we leave here, please look around and make sure that you pick up everything that you came in with. We just really appreciate this gathering. Thank you all.
Thank you.